Thank you. Today, I'd like to talk about the relationship between free groups and the dimension of the second bounded cohomology. Before I start my talk, I think free groups are as free as birds, so it might fly away while I play with them. So in that case, please catch them for me. So during my talk, I denote G as a discrete group. And first, let me introduce the definition of bounded cohomology here. So for every positive integer n, then we consider the cochain group. So this is simply the space of functions f and the product of group g. So we have n many product of g to r. So my coefficient is reals. Okay? Then we can define the boundary operator from cochain group Cn to Cn plus 1. So we denote this one boundary operator Dn. Then when we have this function f, then Dnf, so we have n plus 1 g's in here. 1 to gn plus 1. This one is defined by f of g2 and gn plus 1 plus I is 1 to n minus 1 to I and f g1 and gi and gi plus 1. So this is the group operation in g, and we have gn plus 1 and plus minus 1 to the n plus 1, fg1 to gn. So that's the equation for boundary operator. Then we consider the bounded cochain group as a subspace of this ordinary cochain group. So this f is in the ordinary cochain group, but we define the sum norm. So the norm is sup and x is in gn, so this gn is the product of g and many times, and f of this x, this one is bounded. Okay. Then this bounded cochain group is a subspace of this ordinary cochain group. Okay. And then and then we have this boundary operator in C and G, so there is the n. So we used the same boundary operator in here, so they are the same equation. So we have this, right? So in that case, it's just really easy to see this one is just complex. So the boundary operator, so when we just make the computation, that is zero. So our ordinary cohomology of group, that is defined by cohomology of this by using this ordinary cochain group. In this case, we just denote this one as H. So that's the ordinary cochain group, ordinary cohomology of groups. Okay? And when we use this bounded cochain group, so we have cohomology of these bounded cochain groups. And this one we have using the notation by using hat. So we call this one as the bounded cohomology of G. So there is several facts we have to notice in here. The first, this inclusion homomorphism that gives we have induced homomorphism from bounded cochain group to ordinary bounded cohomology group to ordinary cohomology in here. However, this homomorphism is just a homomorphism. It's not injective, not surjective, any information in here. So when group has some special property, then sometimes it is injective, but in general, we don't have that property. And the second, because we used the real numbers as a coefficient, so that means we have this bounded cohomology. There is a vector space structure over reals. Okay? So actually, this bounded cochain group is a Banach space, right? Because there is a complete norm in here. But this one is the quotient, so we have only semi-norm on here. So this one is simply vector space over R. Okay? So in that case, we can talk about the dimension of this bounded cohomology as a vector space over R. Okay? So that is what I'm going to do. And third, yeah, this one has a vector space structure, and then, yes, so this one is a real vector space, so it is a real vector space, so we can talk about the dimension of this bounded cohomology. Yeah. And, okay. And third, the first bounded cohomology of any group is always just a coefficient. So that is just reals. And when we have the first bounded cohomology, then by using these boundary operators, then this one is just D1 to D2. So we have G1 and G2. Right? So this one is Z2. And by using this, so F of G2 minus F of G1 G2. And plus f of g1, something like this, right? That is d1, right? So kernel d1 is the first bounded cohomology of this G. So that means this one is the space of bounded homomorphisms, but we don't have it. So this one is always zero, right? So in bounded cohomology case, we always start with the second. But it is very difficult to compute this second bounded cohomology or any higher dimension of this bounded cohomology. So we just use the some known facts. So this is the definition. And for my talk, let me introduce some known facts. And first, I did not define the bounded cohomology of space. There is a reason. It is known that bounded cohomology of a topological space, this one is isomorphic to bounded cohomology of its fundamental group. So that is very nice, just property. So whatever it is easier for us, we just compute this way or this way. This is the bounded cohomology of a topological space. So I did not define this part, but this one is just we use
from XXX to the R, or?
Yes, either the real coefficient. So this one is we have this user
map from X.
Yes, yes. Okay. Yes, and then we make it this one to R, like this one. So we make it this one as the CNX. Yeah, this one is the singular case.
Singular chain complex.
Yes.
From singular chain complex to R.
Yes, and then we define the norm in here. We have, what is it? The F norm as the set of singular simplices. So we take it at supremum norm. So F of sigma, and sigma is Sn x like this.
So in case X is a compact space, then
No, no, no. X, just X is a topological space. As long as it has the fundamental group, then we can define this way.
Okay.
Yes. So at first, when they defined this one, they just used this X as a kind of KG one space. But later, the Ivanov proved that it just we need it has the fundamental group. So what is the semi-locally simply connected space or something like this? Then, so. Yes, yes, yes. Everything is the real coefficient. Okay. So that is one nice property. And the second property, when we have the group G, this one is amenable group. So that means there is a right invariant mean on BG. So can I write this way? There is a right, let me write this way, just precisely. We have the mean M.
Would I give you a definition of amenable?
Huh? Do I? Yeah.
No.
So, okay.
I don't know
So we call this one as the mean. So this is simply the functions from G to R, the reals, as the bounded one. So when we have this one said linear functional, okay. So this map is linear, such that the f of x, this one is, mean over f, this one is always between the sup of supremum of f of g for all g. Let me write the maximum. Supremum. Let me write it this way. G. Does it make sense? The minimum, the infimum of this f of g. And G is in G. Then we call this M as the mean on this group, G. And we have group G acts on this space by using right translation, right? So we have G acts on BG, like G and there is F. Or there is another element G prime, then we define this one as right translation like this. Then if M F and M the action of G, this one they are equal for every G in G, then we call this one as a right invariant mean.
This
one is just, we use the right translation.
Yeah, but the group. You mentioned it as group action. So don't you have to put G inverse in the right?
If this is the left multiplication for G, then you have to put inverse. But for the right multiplication, you
yes.
have
yes.
to use this.
Yes,
yes. Because if you have like HG on F, then H can be put on the right hand side, which is the same as
HG is HG prime H times G. But that's the same as. No, you should.
Right, which is not
really. You should put inverse.
Yes, this.
You see?
Make it an action.
Yes, that's right.
Actually, it doesn't matter.
You're right.
Then we call this one as right invariant mean. So if the group G has this right invariant mean, then we call the group G is amenable. So right invariant mean, this M, we call this M is a right invariant mean. So whenever we have group G, and then we can make this linear functional, if there exists this linear functional such that this condition, then we call this group G as amenable. So For example, the easiest one is a finite group. So we just simply just make the all the function values in G and divide by the number of the element in G. So that gives exactly the mean, the finite case.
But if the group is finite, then you don't have to worry about bounding.
We don't. But by using the group is finite, then that is always
the only finite.
Yes.
So
yes. Right. So there is a finite groups and abelian groups and solvable groups. And the homomorphic image of amenable group and direct sum of amenable groups, these are all amenable. And the third, then in that case, so if group G is amenable, then then the bounded cohomology of G is zero for every dimension greater than or equal to one. It's zero is we have a coefficient.
Is this a theorem?
Yes, this is a theorem. And then number three, it is extremely opposite way. When we have free group of rank greater than one, in that case, it is a theorem. And then this one is the second bounded cohomology of this free group is infinite dimensional. So it is kind of the opposite, because when group G, this one contains a free group of rank 2, then it is known that G is not amenable. But the converse is not true. This one is not amenable. So it looks like there is something in amenable group that makes my bounded cohomology is zero. And free groups, that gives the infinite dimensional. So that is, they are just extremely opposite. Right? So, but in here, we know the ordinary cohomology of these free groups rank greater than one. This one is always a zero. Okay? So this one gives another extreme opposite example for ordinary one and bounded cohomology case. It's one. Yes?
Are there some groups in which the bounded cohomology is finite dimensional?
Yes. Yes, there is. So, but let me put something in here. But that is a very special case. That is a very special case. So let me write this. It is, that's the motivation for my talk today. The first, there was a conjecture. That is like the second bounded cohomology of G. This one is either zero or infinite dimensional. There was a conjecture, this one, but I spent...
So the group which contains a non-amenable group as a subgroup, then it's non-amenable?
The group...
Which contains non-amenable group as a subgroup?
Non-amenable group as a subgroup?
So, I mean, the free group of rank 2 is not amenable, right?
Right.
And any group which contains a free group of rank 2 is not amenable.
Right.
So the question is, if a group which has a subgroup which is not amenable,
mm-hmm.
then does it mean that G is amenable or? So you have a free group of rank 2. If it contains
No.
So this is not. So if you replace pre group of rank two by an amenable subgroup, you know.
Let's see. So every subgroup of G is not amenable. But group G
may be amenable. All right. Just a
maybe, but I'm not sure because, for example, when we have the linear groups, GL and R, something like this, this one is not amenable, but this one always contains some free groups, right? So I cannot make any connection directly. So. There is a subgroup that is not amenable, so I'm not sure. Question.
Because that's a quite kind of natural question to ask. Yeah. So you have a non-amenable group and a group which contains non-amenable group. Seems to be it should be non-amenable, but.
Yeah, so that is my kind of the motivation. So it's the group is not amenable. So I change that case is group contains some free group. Then because of this conjecture and because the second bounded cohomology is always just infinite dimensional. So my question is if the group contains a free group of rank greater than equal to 2, then the second bounded cohomology is infinite dimensional or vice versa. That is my motivation in here. So that is kind of the same type of questions, but that is this. But this one is, I proved this one is not true always because there is your question. We have SL2R, the special linear group. This one has the commutator group is free group of rank 2, right? And this one has the second bounded cohomology as non-finite dimension. So that is this. So this example gives the counterexample for this conjecture. But the known counterexamples are all of them from the linear groups.
In that case, you consider SL2R as a space?
Group, as a group.
Your definition is G is a discrete group.
Yes,
but SL2R is not a discrete group.
Do you give a discrete
topology
to that? Or?
When we give as a not discrete group itself, but when we consider as the discrete topology, so we make it discrete group. Okay? Yeah. So that is going to be same with this. Reals, so that has the dimension 1. But this one is true when we just exclude all these linear groups. So we can make that this one is true when we consider group G. This group does not contain non-trivial perfect normal subgroup, then this one is true.
I don't understand. What is the conjecture?
Conjecture is for any group G. The second bounded cohomology is either zero or infinite dimensional. But this one gives the counterexample. So we reduce this any group to the group that does not contain non-trivial perfect normal subgroup, then the conjecture is true. Does not contain a non-trivial perfect normal subgroup. So we call the group that has this property, we call it hyperabelian. That is the name of this the group that has this property. So in that case, the conjecture is true.
For instance, if you consider S, L, N, R, then all of them are going to have also not this property.
They did not compute the S, L, and R, but I think they used some kind of the embedding to this matrix to S, L, and R, kind of that kind of embeddings. So probably this one starts with 3. In that case, from 3 to the higher one, higher N, then all these, the second bounded cohomology, they are isomorphic, but I don't know is 2 to 3. You see? So the second bounded cohomology of SL 3 to R, and this one to, I remember this one, and they have some kind of using embeddings SL and R. I think N is greater than or equal to 3. In that case, they are isomorphic, but I don't know if this one to three case.
Ah, thank you. So I think that for the usual cohomology groups, there is something called the Suslin stability.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
This kind of thing.
Yes, they when they proved this part, they used that kind of property.
It's yes. For GL.
Yes.
So you're saying that for the bounded cohomology, also the Suslin stability kind of thing is
true. Yes, yes. Okay, and then, so my question is, then, because the amenable group and free groups of rank greater than 1, they are kind of the extreme opposite part. So when we have the group G that contains a free group of rank greater than 1, then can we say the bounded cohomology is infinite, the second bounded cohomology is infinite dimensional or not? That is my question. So, and as our main theorem, so what I found, if I give the definition, if group G is residually solvable, I give you the definition, then you see there is this kind of the perfect groups. And then this one is the first commutator subgroup is perfect. So I have to consider some commutator subgroups. So in that case, it's residually solvable. And the second bounded cohomology of G, this one is infinite dimensional if and only if G, and this one is the nth commutator subgroup of G, this is free of rank greater than or equal to 2, where n is for some finite ordinal in here. Okay. So I'm going to prove this one.
So C is residually solvable.
Yes.
Then H star G, H2, G is infinite dimensional if and only, right?
Yes.
This statement
is very difficult. G is residually solvable.
That's
a hypothesis,
right?
Yes. And if that's the second bounded cohomology of.
So you are saying that if Gn is free of rank 2, then G is also residually solvable?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
So
yes.
Oh.
Yes. Yes. I'll show that part too. Okay. So to prove this one, let me give you some properties of these residually solvable groups. So that is about residually solvable groups. Because I'm going to put this finite ordinal because I'm going to make
what's
the
finite ordinal of rank of
N. Yes, because I'm going to define the transfinite defined derived subgroup of G. Okay. So the first definition, we say group G is residually solvable. The formal definition is for every non-identity element in G, this is not identity, there is a normal subgroup N of G such that G does not, G is not contained in this normal subgroup, and the quotient, this one is solvable. Then we call this group G is residually solvable. That's the definition. So, simple example, group G is solvable. Then we can take our N as the trivial group. Okay? So solvable groups is always residually solvable. Okay? And the other nice, nice one is a free group. Free group of rank 1, that is just abelian group, that is solvable. So that is residually solvable. And even the free group of rank 2, this one is rank greater than 1. This case, this one is the example, it's residually solvable, but not solvable. So that is like this. We have abelian groups, right? Abelian groups are solvable groups. So up to here, we are in the territory of amenable groups. So second bounded cohomology is zero, right? And then there is residually solvable groups. Okay? And then in here, we have free groups of rank 2. So we have this. So for this, we have to see something about commutator subgroups. So it's about the commutators. So we defined it inductively. So we define G as the zeroth commutator itself. And for every finite ordinal, every finite number, the nth commutator subgroup as G n minus 1's commutator 1, and then we take the commutator. So it's inductively, so this one is G n minus 1 and G n minus 1. Right? And then for limit ordinals, so this one is just finite ordinal. And then when we have limit ordinal delta, then delta's commutator group as the intersection for every ordinal less than delta, and we take the alpha's commutator subgroups. So we don't need to go far, too much limit ordinals, because residually solvable is just stops at some nice place.
No.
That is like this. G is the zeroth commutator. Then we have G1. And we have some nth commutator. Then my first limit ordinal, we call it, this one is denoted by omega. So this one is for every finite n, right? And Gn. Right. So this one is going to be my first limit ordinal. Okay? And then we have now and then G, omega plus 1. And then when we have G omega 2, that is my second limit ordinal. Then in that case, we make the intersection for every ordinal less than omega 2. Okay? But we don't need to worry about this part at this time. And when we make this, then the residually solvable is very nicely acting here. So G is residually solvable, then it's really easy to say if and only if G omega is trivial. The first limit ordinary is trivial. So so I'm not going to prove this. For example, if G is just the solvable, then some finite ordinal Gn is, so this part is really easy. And then this one is we just used this definition. Right. Then it's easy to prove.
In general, it is going to be easy and yes. You can find
the proof? You can prove it by, no, you can.
It's an exercise.
Yeah, you can prove by using the definition.
Okay.
And then number three. Now, to make it this one, to connect this to the free groups, because I'm interested in free groups, so I just consider the group presentation of G. So let's write this one as the quotient of free group. Okay? Then we know the nth commutator subgroup. This one is simply the nth commutator of F, K, and of the quotient. Can I write this way? Quotient of this. Okay. So that means for every finite ordinal, this nth commutator subgroup gives the exact sequence of this, right? So I'm going to call this one as, so this one gives, there is exact induced from this, we have K, Fn K, and Gn for every finite ordinal n, right? Because our residually solvable group has the limit ordinal, at that point we have trivial group. Also, so this part is just simply by using the group property. So this one is going to be, we have something like this. So remember, this one is we just intersect all the lower ordinals. So that is going to be intersection of F of n k, n is less than omega, and g omega is 1. This one is also exact. So up to here, for every commutator subgroup gives this exact sequence. Okay? So that is the property. And this is kind of the main property here. When G is residually solvable, and if and only if one of these exact sequences is trivial, that means split. So either the exact sequence Gn for some finite ordinal n, or at the limit ordinal, the exact sequence G omega, this one is split. But that is very nice property in here, because if the sequence is split, then we have the lifting in here, right? And then this one is a semi-direct product of K and Gn, right? So that means Gn becomes the free groups, right? So that is very nice property. So by using this, when G is residually solvable, then my second bounded cohomology of this G is either zero or infinite dimensional. So that's the power of the conjecture, the Fujiwara's conjecture in here. Yeah. So, and then by using this, I'm going to prove my main theorem, but let me introduce one more. Okay. in general, when we have exact sequence 1 and ng, and g mod n, when we have this exact sequence, for any exact sequence, then SD ordinary cohomology groups, bounded cohomology also has the 5-term exact sequence. So we have exact sequence 0 to H2 G mod N. I start H2 because my bounded cohomology, the dimension 1 is always 0. So we don't care about this one. This one to G. And this one is just invariant of G mod N action. And H3 G mod N. And H3G, so we have 5-term exact sequence. Now this one is very nice because when we make the quotient as a solvable, like this, I erased that part, then solvable groups are amenable, so this part and this part, they are zero, so we have isomorphic groups. I mean, these two vector spaces are isomorphic, right? Mm. So we have this one. So now let's prove of the main theorem. So that was like this. If G is residually solvable and its second bounded cohomology is infinite dimensional, if and only if Gn is free of rank greater than 1. That was my main theorem. Okay? So we consider this group presentation. So we write G as F mod K. Right? So for free F, now, if F is free of rank 1, then my F is abelian, right? So its quotient is also abelian, that is solvable, that is amenable, right? So that is solvable, that becomes residually solvable, and solvable group cannot have the commutator as a free of rank greater than 1, right? So we assume. That is the this one. Yeah. So in when we have when G acts on some space V, then we just make the V invariant. So this one is.
So is G quotient N is acting on this
cohomology? Yes, yes, as by using the conjugation action. So we assume the rank over F is greater than 1. Okay? And also, if K is trivial, then I have G is just a free group, right? If K is trivial, then I have just a free group, so we are done. So also we assume K is not trivial. That means K is also free group because the subgroup of free group is free. So that means my K may have rank 1. So the rank of K is greater than equal to 1. So that's the only difference. So we assume this. Then this part. We suppose G is residually solvable, and the second bounded cohomology is not is infinite dimensional. So, G is residually solvable. Then one of these is one of these going to split. Right. So, if this one does not split for every finite ordinal n, then then this one must split, right? So when this part, this one split, then in this case, I proved this one long time ago, so this one becomes zero. So this is ruled out from this assumption. There is the long proof about this. Yes. So in this case, I used this exact sequence and all the inclusions, and then we can prove this part. So this is not the case. So for some finite ordinal n, the exact sequence, this one should be splitting. So this one must split for some finite ordinal n. Right? Then we are done, right? Because this one split I explained before, so we have the lifting. So there is the subgroup Q, this one such that Q is isomorphic to Gn, right? And then this one is this is also free group, right? So subgroup of free group, so this is free, so this is free, right? And if the rank of Gn, the nth commutator is 1, that means nth commutator is abelian, so then must be solvable. So that is not the case, right? So that means the rank of Gn should be greater than 1. So that is that part, this part. And this part, rank is Gn is 1, that means Gn is, this one is going to be isomorphic to infinite cyclic group, so that is abelian. So then the next commutator should be trivial, right? So that means my G is solvable. In that case, the second bounded cohomology is 0. So that should be ruled out from my assumption. Okay? So now, opposite part, so let the Gn, this one be free of rank greater than 1. And then for some finite ordinal n. Then this is the hard part. I asked you to catch the free groups when they fly away. So then this one is rank greater than 1, that means the next one. This one is a subgroup of this one, so this is free of infinite. Right? So whenever we have the free group of rank greater than or equal to 2, then its commutator groups has infinite rank, right? So this one is free of infinite rank, right? Now, here, we assume that the rank of my free group F is greater than 1. So that means its commutator, the first commutator, this one is free of infinite rank, right? So the rank in free group is invariant, right? So that means this Gn plus 1, n plus 1 commutator subgroup and the first commutator subgroup of F, they are isomorphic as a free of infinite rank. Okay. So they have the second bounded cohomology, right? Now, everything is coming from this exact five-term exact sequence. Okay, so if I make it quickly, I have 5 minutes. So that is like this. Let me make your diagram. So H hat the second bounded cohomology of G, this one is isomorphic of second bounded cohomology of n plus 1th commutator subgroup G mod G n plus 1, because G mod G n plus 1 is solvable, so they are 0, so we have isomorphism, right? And because G n plus 1, the n plus 1th commutator subgroup is isomorphic to the first commutator of F, so this one should be 2, this one is F1. Now, what is this? This one is G's presentation F mod K, G n plus 1, that is F n plus 1 K mod K, right? So it's quite F1. It's a commutator subgroup, right? So that means this part should be F mod F n plus 1 K. Then, now, this n plus 1th commutator subgroup is normal subgroup of F1, and the quotient is solvable, right? So I'm going to apply this five-term exact sequence as F1 and Fn plus 1. Then that gives, now this part, that is same with second bounded cohomology of F n plus 1th commutator subgroup, and we have invariant of F n plus 1. That is this part in the circle, right? Using this five-term exact sequence. And then we have, there is another action, F and F n plus 1 K, right? So that is just like second bounded cohomology of F n plus 1. And what is this? F1 is a subgroup of this F. So we have F F n plus 1 K. Right? Now, F n plus 1, this one is a subgroup of F n plus 1 K, right? So that means when I make the quotient of this F n plus 1 K, right, this one is, you can just consider this one as a just subset, right? F is F n plus 1 as a subset, right? Then every element in here, such that they are invariant to invariant in this section, right? And they are invariant in this section, then they should be invariant in this section, right? So that means this one contains the second bounded cohomology of this F n plus 1, F and mod F n plus 1, right? Now, what is F mod F n plus 1? This one is again solvable, right? So we apply F n F n plus 1 in here as G and n again. Then because the quotient F bar F n plus 1 is solvable, so these two are 0, so I have F n F n plus 1. So this one is going to be isomorphic to F. What is this? Because our free group F has rank greater than or equal to 1, so this is infinite dimensional, so that means this is infinite dimensional. So the proof is done. So my talk is up to here.
This bounded cohomology